I think I'm recording at least, so I might get home and realise I've not, but... Okay, so today, what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take you through the life of Donald McBane. My background with this guy was in my Masters in War Studies. I studied Glasgow University, holds one of his books, there's five known, one at the National Library of Scotland. Glasgow Museums holds one, then there's one or two in private collections, and then Glasgow Uni has the upper one. And I kind of came across them by accident. I was fascinated by Sword and Targe, and he's one of the handful of sources we have on Sword and Targe. But after I came across him, I kind of fell in love with the guy. He's an absolutely fantastic read. I mean, I'm assured for small sword and spadroon stuff, his later parts on how to fight are very good. But his story is something else. He was just a regular soldier. He's not an officer or anything fancy like that. He becomes a sergeant at the end of his career with the military. So it's a nice little insight into a regular soldier that also happened to be a pimp, a thief, a murderer. This guy kind of did it all. He had a spectacular career. So I'm going to start out, read out. He writes a little poem about himself. He's a little bit big-headed, okay? So I'll start by reading out his little poem, and then we'll go through his life. All right, so to the offer, or the offer to the reader. Okay. Thrice sprightly reader, it is bane requires that this his labours lightens your desires, to marshal glory while hereby wills, and hopes you'll shun appearance of ills. None better is than this for self-defence, when taken in a true and genuine sense. Time was the offer travelled far and near under the notion of a musketeer, and shortly after to a pikeman rose, placed in the forefront to offend our foes. Soon after, for the space of 20 years, was I one of the royal grenadiers, enrolled in Lord George Hamilton's command, the hope and honour of our native land. In 16 battles fought in I have been, and 52 great sages I have seen. 50 and 16 times did I advance, in Flanders, Holland, Germany, and France. My country's cause, hot skirmishes I joined, and victories of my enemies I obtained. My fourth course was a sergeant of dragoons, well known at Preston and at other towns. And lastly, I'm Fort William's cannoneer. Thanks be to God, my enemies I don't fear. Who was so oft embroiled in bloody wars, indent as 'twere, and carved with cuts and scars, which fortune seemed to favour and o'erlook, that I might serve you with this little book. Buy it and try it, then upon my word, a good tongue still will prove a trusty sword. But where there's no evading of a strife, here's what will serve you to save your life. So count it not a fault in me if you're the father of a plea. Okay, so it's good at writing. All right, so already we like the guy. Right, so Donald McBane is born in 1664. We can work this out by... He gives us a date later on and tells us how old he is. So 1664, 1665. And he's born up near Inverness. He doesn't tell us much about his parents. His dad dies shortly after the point that he starts telling us about in the book. And his mum later kicks him out of the house, and it's the last we hear about them. Now, what's interesting is that from one of the stories later on, we do find out that he's a Gaelic speaker. He's at least capable of understanding and conversing in it, if he's not native in it. And his very first engagement, he comes across clansmen. So he is a Highlander. He knows what the Highlanders are doing if he hasn't been trained in it himself. Prior to 1687, probably at about the age of 17, he becomes an apprentice tobacco spinner. Okay, Scotland was moving hell of a lot of tobacco in this period. It was coming up through us and then moving on. So that's what he did. But he left it because he didn't feel he was being fed enough. He felt that his evening ration should have been the ration for every meal of the day, of which he felt there should be about 5. So the guy liked to eat, apparently. And he felt it was completely unfair because he was a young growing man that he wasn't fed enough. So he runs away. And first thing he does is he enlists in the military, and we're taught that he fights in a clan dispute between McIntosh and MacDonald. All right, so he's at this age, I think he's 23 years old, and this is his first real engagement. And we know that he's given a really crummy musket, and it's got a plug bayonet in the barrel. And during this clan dispute, he talks about there's Lochaber axes, swords and targes. This is old school clan style stuff going on. And so in the middle of the dispute, he comes face to face with a Highlander. And the Highlander just goes ahead and cuts the bayonet out of his barrel. And he seems a little bit shocked by this. Probably it's a terrifying experience to have your one weapon and you hold it up and the Highlander's, and you're like, oh. Well, that's that. He does take a swing at the Highlander with the butt of his weapon. However, his weapon's a bit crummy, and the butt goes flying off in the other direction. So he serves to anger this Highlander a lot. So he takes off and starts running. And for his first two battles, this is kind of a theme. And he runs. He tells us that he runs for 30 miles, and he believes everyone's his enemy. So he's probably running for a town like a complete madman, with people sort of looking at him, and he's running along, sort of being like, ah! All right, so... that's his first experience of warfare, so he doesn't really see much other than it's very violent and bloody. Following that, he enlists again in King William III's service under Grant's regiment during the Glorious Revolution. And for the majority of this, he doesn't do much. A lot of marching up and down the country, but that's about it. And then he, in 1689, he's placed in the ranks at Killiecrankie. Has anyone here been to the field of Killiecrankie? Alright, cool. So, Killiecrankie, just to describe it a little bit, what we have is there's like a ridge up the top, and then there's a hill, and then it dips, and then there's the bit that the British line formed up on. Okay, so he'd have formed up on like this ridge under above the dip. And what happened at Killiecrankie is it's the most successful Highland charge that gets recorded. Lots of people talk mainly about the Highland charge, what happens there. So he's set himself up and everything, and the Highlanders come and they form up on the top of the hill. And this is where a myth enters the whole idea of the Highlanders. The Highlanders fired their muskets very early on, right up near the top. Okay, what this causes is it causes a smoke to roll down the hill. That's what gets described by the officers of the day. The smoke rolls down the hill. And this gives the Highlanders a bit of cover. Now, the Highlanders make a yell, their Highland yell, it becomes quite famous. And for years we weren't very sure what this was. A lot of us just assumed it was like, yeah, and that was it. However, further research into the Highland yell tells us that we know that the southern states during the Civil War are performing the rebel yell, and there's descriptions that it's similar to what this Highland yell would have been. And it is a truly horrific noise. It's done by everyone's making different noises offset to each other, so not everyone's yelling with each other, we're all offset, and it makes this cacophony is really the only way to describe it. So you can imagine for a young British soldier, he's on the line, he can't actually see his enemy at this point, and then there's this horrific yelling. It sounds like a yelping of dogs kind of thing, barking sounds and whatnot. Then they come down the hill, and obviously they build up a hell of a lot of momentum coming down this hill. When the British fire, the Highlanders would go to ground, they'd drop, so the musket fire would just go over them. And the British at this time didn't count on being able to see their enemy, they just count on the fact that they were going to shoot and they were going to hit. If their enemy was standing up, the enemy was down. However, obviously, the Highlanders go to ground, they're fine, then they perform the final part of their charge, and they come up on McBane's line, and they completely decimate the unit at Killiecrankie. The British line is scattered, and it's not going so well. So McBane, in his infinite wisdom, has once again a Highlander coming towards him. So he starts running, and he comes across a horse that's been unmanned. So he grabs the horse, and he starts trying to hide between the horse and the Highlander, right? So he's got this horse, and he says it was a weird sight for anyone looking on, because he's trying to maneuver the horse between him and what is clearly a very angry Highlander at this point. So he carries on doing this, and he comes to a pass. And now, when I was growing up, we'd heard of the Soldier's Leap, and we'd heard of this pass, the Killiecrankie Burn, and I kind of expected to see sort of a little burn, maybe about 5 feet long, all on the same level, and he just sort of hops over it. No, it's quite It's quite impressive when you see it. The burn's about 18 feet up. Where he was, it's about 18 feet up. Then there's a burn at the bottom, and then ground over here. And what he decides is that if he stays, this Highlander is going to kill him. There's no way out of that. If he leaps, he will probably die, but he's got a shot. So he jumps. Now, what's unfortunate is, but this jump then goes on to get recorded in every map. It's still recorded in modern maps, the area where he made his soldiers leap. And this is the thing that poor Donald McBane becomes the most famous for, is the one battle where he runs away. Now, like he said in his little poem, he has another 30 years of fighting. He's at the forefront of siege after siege. But the only thing anyone remembers is the one time where he leaps away from a Highlander. So there you go. So that's his... Pardon?
Can I ask just a question?
Yes.
Theory that it's not as wide, it wasn't as wide then.
Yes, but it's still high.
The height is here, but actually,
yeah, that the burn was a little bit, yeah. But you're still dealing with a massive. When I first got there, because I just assumed, like I said, I assumed he was jumping over something white as death. I was like, good on you, big thing. But when you see it, no, you have to be impressed by what this guy pulls off. So after that experience, he quits, moved up to Fort William and begins construction of it. And remember this part, because it's a nice end to the story as well. So he builds Fort William, and it takes about roughly 2 years from his description to finish Fort William. So we're now in 1692. And in 1692, he joins Colonel Forbes' company, who decide to, they're going to stay at the fort. It was three companies there to leave his state. So he's hanging out at the fort. And at this time, an old soldier would look after younger soldiers, pay for them. By look after, I mean steal. There's really no way around that. So McBane decides that he's had enough. This old soldier's just taking a piss. So he borrows a sword from a friend, and he goes and sees a fencing master for 2 weeks, all right? And what he borrows is actually a small sword, all right? So he learns some small sword for 2 weeks with a perfectly decent fencing master from his description. And then he gets the joy of coming up, and he finds this old soldier, and he says, I want to fight. And the old soldier goes, fuck off. And he says, no, we're going to fight this out. So eventually the old soldier is like, all right, fine. So they go outside, and the old soldier happens to pull out a broadsword, for which McBane hadn't considered at all. So the old soldier disarms him, and then pawns the sword that he borrowed from a friend for 2 barrels of beer. So McBane's friend is pissed, because McBane's friend's watching his nice sword disappear into the ether, and now McBane's got no friends. All right. So McBane is a stubborn git. So he goes back and he borrows some money, steals the sword this time, he doesn't borrow it, and goes back to the fencing master and says, what do you do, a broadsword versus a small sword? And the fencing master goes over how to do this. Okay, so he goes back and he finds satisfaction with his old soldier, and this time he gets it. And when he gets it, he gives his friend back the sword that the old soldier had pawned. He returns the swords he had borrowed. And this is sort of the start of his career as a swordsman. He's fascinated by it, and he's very, very proud of himself. He takes this as a sign that he is a gift from God. So he's now in charge of his own pay. He's a man, and no one's taking his stuff off of him. So, he's got a bit of a name for himself, and 20 men from his company are to be sent over to Flanders. Now, from the description of this, is really kind of odd, and I've never quite come to terms with it. The men are stripped of their weapons, chained up, and marched. I guess they assumed they were going to desert or something. So, and McBane is one of the ones who's to take them. So he's taking his mates down to ship them away, all right? And he gets on the ship with them and has a couple of drinks. And when he wakes up, the ship is halfway over to Flanders. So McBane says, oh, just drop me off here. And the captain says, well, no. Now, the captain was probably paid per able-bodied man he delivered. So the captain had no intention of dropping McBane off. So McBane heads over to Flanders and starts his career over there. Well, once he gets to Flanders, he joins Lord Orkney's Royal Regiment against the city of Namur, and they fight six sieges against Namur between 1692 and 1695. And from what McBane describes, he's actually not unhappy in this line of work. He seems to enjoy sieges quite a bit. So in 1696, his captain from Colonel Forbes' company happens to be there and comes across McBane. And the captain decides to trade two men to get McBane back. The captain obviously quite likes McBane, so he brings McBane home. So 1696, he heads home, and in the 20th of September 1697, his regiment is disbanded and he's sent home to mummy. Okay, so he goes home to his mum, and his mum can't afford to keep him, especially with him not being able to work or anything. So his mum gives him 20 shillings, which in today's money is roughly £400, and sends him to go seek his fortune. Oh, and he gets a coat as well and his mother's blessing. So off he goes, and so he heads out, and he enlists in the Earl of Angus's regiment as a pikeman, and he's doing quite okay there until a certain corporal insults him. McBane just cannot walk away, all right? So he demands satisfaction because the corporal basically said that he wasn't working hard enough and put him on another shift of watch. So McBane demands satisfaction, and the corporal offers to give him it. So they go out, and they're fighting away, and McBane lets his Highland temper get the best of him, and he stabs the corporal. And the corporal believes that he's dying, McBane thinks he's dying. And the problem here is that due to first blood, the army kind of turned their back on that, was fine. Killing an officer, however, meant the gallows. So the corporal, I guess, quite liked McBane. I've read in McBane's book, everybody quite likes McBane, so he might have skewed that. But anyway, corporal says to him, you know, you idiot, you've killed me. Here's 2 shillings, make your way down to Glasgow and get away, right? So McBane's really, really upset that, to the level that this is probably sort of the first person he's sort of stabbed right in front of him. He's really, really bothered by this. So he takes his shillings and he flees to Glasgow. And he's told that once he gets to Glasgow, join the Royal Regiment of Scots. Okay? So he gets to Glasgow and he comes across some recruiters for the Royal Regiment of Scots. And he beats the shit out of them. Clearly not thinking about his future very much here. The drummer, who was probably like a kid about 14 years old, throws his sticks at McBane and then runs away, which is quite amusing. And McBane kicks the hell out of the other two. So he realises that he's in a bit of trouble again and runs off to Tor Wood and hides out there. And then in the morning, he goes and he finds Captain Coburn of the Royal Regiment of Scots. And Captain Coburn, presumably not knowing what he's done the day before, says, yes, I'll take you, find my sergeant, you're on your way to Ireland. So that's it. McBane's now heading off to Ireland. When he gets to Ireland, he has his first run-in, he tells us about, with a prostitute. He spends the night with her, and but nothing happens, because halfway through the night, when things are about to get a bit interesting, her husband bursts in, and so McBane and her husband fight it out, and her husband uses a chair against them, which he feels fit to tell us all about. So they battle it out. It's great. The landlady comes up, puts a stop to it, and then it turns out that McBane's a soldier, and the husband's like, oh my god, I wouldn't have attacked you if I'd known you were a soldier. But the landlady says, well, you've got to pay for the mess you cause. McBane says, I don't have the money. So McBane, the guy who fought, the prostitute, and one of the recruiting sergeants all kind of chip in together, and they all have a drink together and enjoy the rest of the night and become friends. This is a theme throughout all of McBane's books. He fights someone, they drink, they become best friends. He's in Ireland, he's found out a little bit about whoring, and Then he sets himself up with a French fencing master, and that goes well for about a month and a half. Then he demands satisfaction. They head out onto Oxmington green. And McBane wounds him and wounds the fencing master in three places. Okay. After this, they have a drink and become friends. And he continues with the fencing master for another 2 weeks, I think. But I think it's sort of more on equal terms. So everything's happy. He's having a good old time. Then he's given orders and he marches to Limerick. Now this is where sort of he stops being a fun, lovable character and becomes a bit of an arsehole. He meets a farmer's daughter, who he clearly kind of fancies a little bit, and so he calls a priest to the inn, and the girl had a fairly sizable dowry. So the priest comes, and they tell the girl, now this is how we know that he can speak Gaelic, they tell the girl to go ahead and just repeat whatever the priest says. So the priest says, aren't you a bit young to get married? And the girl turns to the priest and goes, aren't you a bit young to get married? The priest goes, are you mad? The girl turns to the priest and goes, are you mad? And this charade carries on for a little while. And at the end of it, the priest storms out because the girl's insulted him quite badly and he's pissed off by wasting his time. So that's fine. Then McBane and his mates tell this poor girl that she is now married to McBane. They take the dowry, and after that, McBane's leaves, and this poor girl believes she's married until she speaks to her mother, who eventually works out what's happened, but by this time McBane's spent the dowry, and so this is the first instance of McBane being just a pure arsehole for no real reason. So we don't like him at that stage, and that's probably around 1698. Now, 1699 rolls around, and McBane decides to set up his first school in Limerick, and this is where things get a wee bit interesting. Whenever McBane sets up a school, he has to fight all the other fencing masters in the city. This was fairly common in the time, it's nothing unusual. McBane seems to go a bit out of his way to accomplish this, but he does. And there's a girl that he wishes to marry in Limerick. And her brother happens to be one of the other fencing masters. So they have a duel, but McBane doesn't tell us what happens. Now, what we know later on in the story is McBane is married. He doesn't tell us anything about the woman. So we can assume that he probably beat her brother, went on to marry her, because it's one of the only women that we're told about in this story. So that's most likely the end result. The other alternative is that the fencing master beat him, and he didn't feel like saying, I was slaughtered by a fencing master, okay? So that's his trip in Limerick. And then he marches to Cork, and there's a great number of desertions on the way to Cork. So the captain decides to put 5 men to guard McBane, so he doesn't desert, fair enough. The 5 men that are guarding him desert. So McBane comes in and kind of does what I told you so, and he kind of dances around the subject in his book a little bit. You know, I was the good one, I showed up at the end. So that's his trip to Cork, and from Cork they travel to Bolsh at Brabant. And when he gets there, a ghost from his past appears. The man he thought he'd killed comes out of nowhere. So naturally, McBane and him have a drink and become lifelong friends. Now what's interesting is this is the one friend that we know that he stays in touch with. He tells us that later on, after all the wars and everything passed, the guy sets up a pub in London and then moves his pub to Gravesend. Okay, so he clearly stays in touch with this guy and they genuinely are lifelong buddies. But either way, drink, friendship, that's how it works with McBane. So after that story, he decides that he sees game masters are playing a pair of games he describes, but I can't work them out to today's games. So anyway, they're running the games in town, and he decides he wants a piece of that. He doesn't want to earn it, he just wants them to give him like a piece of it. This seems to be a thing with McBane. So he sets up to duel the 4 pimps and game masters. And here we have, he describes one of them as being left-handed. Now, in Scotland, left-handedness can also be used as like a derogatory term for a sneaky person. And with this story, it might actually mean a sneaky person, not actually left-handed, how we describe it. Anyway, so Him and the left-handed guy. And what you've got to imagine, have you all seen the Three Musketeers, the Disney version a few years ago? All right. You know D'Artagnan's first duel in it, where he meets them all and they're fighting up on the castle walls and stuff. It's a bit like that. They go up onto the palisade, and he's dueling away with the left-handed, or the one he describes as left-handed, and they've checked each other for pistols, like they do in a duel, but the left-handed guy sort of steps back and goes, all right, McBane is shot. And he takes this really badly. His description goes off on a bit of a rant about how unfair this was. So anyway, he thinks he's now shot and dying. Eventually, he realizes he's not. So he takes after the guy. And he chases the guy down and stabs the guy in the buttocks, just for good measure. That's his, one of his early duels. So, at this point, he is given the right to earn some money, and he starts earning about £4 a week from this business. Now, to put this into today's money, that's about equivalent of £1,200 a week. Now, roughly £62,400 a year this guy's making. Now, you'll see later in the story, this is nothing compared to his future earnings. McBane was one rich guy, very, very wealthy. Anyway, like all good things, it comes to an end. In 1702, the French attack where he's staying in Nijmegen, and he loses everything. The French strip the wives, and this is the first time he mentions his wife. They had stripped. It might mean that they were whipped, but most likely they were just made naked and sent back to them. And McBane makes an offhand comment that some of us would have preferred that the French just keep them. So he's got a bit of humour there. And so anyway, he's lost everything. He's a bit down on his luck. So he goes to his captain and asks to borrow some eight crowns to buy a bottle or a barrel of ale and get started again. So he borrows the 8 crowns. And on his way to buy the ale, he sees a gambling operation and decides that he's going to up his luck. He loses all 8 crowns. But being the lovely gentleman that he is and totally fair, he waits until the guy who won leaves, feeds the shit out of him, and takes 60 crowns. Now, what he didn't count on was that this guy had friends in the village, and by friends, I mean pretty much everyone, turns and starts attacking McBane. So McBane takes off, and he's sword fighting people, and he runs forever. He goes into great description about his long run, and he gets back to his regiment, where he's now safe. He comes into his tent where his wife is, and his wife starts sort of smacking him around the head when she realizes he's not got any barrel of ale with him. She thinks that he's just lost the money. So she's pissed, right? She's beating the hell out of him. McBane, instead of just saying, woman, I've got 60 crowns, calm down, he just lets her believe that he's lost the ale, calls the surgeon. Him and the surgeon drink, which infuriates his wife even more, spending money he doesn't have. And then he throws 30 crowns at her, keeps 30 crowns for himself, he keeps 20 crowns for himself, sorry, and he gives the guy who lent him 8 crowns 10 crowns back. So he does the right things, sort of. So she goes out, buys new clothes, he gets himself some nice new clothes, and so while he's there, he fights many sieges in this area. He doesn't go into much detail about all of them, but at the Siege of Luke, McBane is in the forlorn hope, which means he's one of the first guys in there. Like I said, this guy's got balls ever after his soldier's leap incident. So he's first one in, he's blowing shit up, he's killing people, it's all good. And he's told to kill everyone. They were told to kill no survivors. But apparently they don't feel right with this. So McBane comes across a French, the commander of a fort, and the French commander basically sees that he hasn't been killing women and children and goes, all right, you're a sound guy. Look, I'm going to reward you. So McBane and him go deep down into the fort and he opens a door. And I sort of imagine this like the DuckTales, what's his name, Scrooge McDuck or whatever. He opens the door and there's just gold, lots and lots of gold. So McBane gets himself 2 bags of gold. It's clearly sort of one of us running out with about 70 to 100 grand in our hands, all right? So he's very happy with himself. And he's running back and everyone's cheering and everything. And he sees a grenade, and he can't help himself. He picks up the grenade to chuck it at the enemy, because why not add insult to injury? And when he does, the grenade blows up in his hand, kills everyone around him, blows him off the battlement, okay? And the battlements that look, the sort of smallest ones that were there were about 25 feet off the ground. So he's got one hell of a drop, blows himself up. Obviously he's covered, he's burned, the money's long gone. And so his men pick him up and they carry him home. And they pretty much say to his wife, he's going to die, don't waste your time. But anyway, his wife loves him and she covers him in milk. But the surgeon won't even bother looking at him. And he sort of looks in the tent and goes, nah, fuck that, and moves on. So the wife gets some members of a monastic order to take him. And they take him and they put him in a bath of like fat, like lard, really. And he has a, every day they cut open his lips so that they can give him something to drink. And for a month he just lies there. At the end of a month, he gets up, he's right as rain, and goes right back into the fighting. Okay, so clearly this guy's hard. His picture is a nice picture. I don't believe it's at all how he looked. By the time this guy gets to the end of his life, I think he was fairly monstrous. But anyway, so he's been burned, he's been blown up, and so that's the siege of Luck. So eventually he's all good, everything's better. So once he's fully recovered from his burns, he naturally sets up his business again, gets himself a couple of whores, gets some gaming going, does a little bit of swordsmanship instruction, and in 1703 manages to get himself captured by some French dragoons. So he's caught and he's being marched by the dragoons on his horse, and he gets captured because he wouldn't just hand over his horse. Whenever McBane has something and someone tells him to hand it over, he tells them to go fuck themselves, which is not a good way of keeping yourself safe. So the French dragoon has him on the horse, he's tied up, and the French dragoon goes to use the toilet, and McBane jumps off the horse and kicks the French dragoon over and runs away. Okay, so he comes back, he returns to his regiment, he's now got the French dragoon's stuff, the nice horse, and so when he goes back to regiment, he's a bit of a hero again, at least he thinks he is. He sells all of that and sets up business yet again. Then they're all marched down to the Danube, where they fight battle against the Duke of Bavaria. The reason I list this battle and not some of the others is, at this battle, he is shot in the thigh and stabbed 3 times with a bayonet. He walks away at the end of it. So you can imagine, this guy's fairly hard. So we get to 1704, and he fights in the Battle of Blenheim. Now, he doesn't, obviously today we know this was a very important battle and a big battle. He describes it as a long battle, but obviously isn't very aware of just the importance of the battle that he's in. Anyway, he fights there. He is shot 4 times, stabbed 5 times, and eventually he's just left for dead. When they leave him for dead, they put like some dead bodies on top of him, try to sort of hide him in some hay and stuff. But that's it. And then later, one of his allies comes out and steals all the stuff off of him. And then even later, a Dutchman, and he doesn't like the Dutch, not very much at all. Anyway, one of them comes and takes the shirt off his back, which probably why he doesn't like the Dutch so much. So he's not a happy camper. And so anyway, he's lying there, and he's incredibly thirsty, so he starts drinking blood, just handfuls and handfuls of blood. Now, obviously, I'm assuming no one in this room has drank blood before, but it's very salty, and it dehydrates you even more. So it wasn't the best idea he had. So eventually he's found and he's taken, and to make him recover, they have to give him so much water that he starts throwing up blood. So it's all kind of icky. And anyway, so it takes him about, well, he says 1 month into his recovery, he finds out that there's gaming in this area. So naturally, he challenges all the game masters to a duel, what you need to do when you're recovering from multiple stab wounds and shootings and all the rest of it. But anyway, he fights the 3 of them for his share of the game profits. He wins, And once again, they all have a drink and become best friends. Now later on, he does tell us he goes back and he meets these guys again. And so they do sort of stay in touch, and these guys sort of run his business in that area. So anyway, they're all friends again. So for 2 years, he does quite well there. And then in 1706, he fights in the Siege of Bath. And this time, he gets shot in the head. And he says that even when he's writing a book, the bullet's still there and occasionally gives him issues. I assume it would. And so, yes, once again, he has to go into recovery. And during his recovery, he sets up a fighting school and a whorehouse and does very well fighting and touring. So you're seeing there's a theme to this guy. Every time he gets knocked down, he gets back up again and sets up whoring, fighting, gambling. So anyway, right. So he's, we're now in 1707, he's doing well, and he fights and defeats a French Gascon from the Dutch Blue Guards, and he describes this guy as the worst person ever. He goes into a lot of detail about how bad this is, and everyone hates him, so it's not just me. And the guy's big. So the guy drags him out, and you know, there's everyone set up around, and the guy's dug McBane's grave already. So McBane takes this extremely badly. Anyway, he fights. Presumably, from his description, he's faster. He's able to get... he says that he tries not to, but it doesn't sound like he tries very hard. Anyway, he stabs the guy through the heart and leaves the guy far dead, clutching his breast, sitting beside his future grave. So he beats the French because it's good. All right, so... he's quite pleased with himself for that, and he says everyone loves him for it. That's up for discussion. But anyway, he then gives us a detail of how much money he's earning in this period. From his whores, he is earning 32 crowns a week. Now, this is equivalent to £2,500 today, every week, roughly £130,000 a year. Now, any period I told you that that year has just passed, or a few years... He's been running these businesses during that time. This guy is loaded by this time. He is a very, very wealthy gentleman. So later on, he gets into an argument with a French quartermaster and describes him as an old French quartermaster. Now, this is an interesting duel. It's the only one like this. He fights him. And they fight, and they fight, and neither can get the better of the other. And this just keeps going round after round. So eventually the two of them just go, all right, well, now we're obviously going to win this. Let's call it a day. Naturally, they go along to the local pub, and they drink and become lifelong friends. So once again, he just stays true to character. But he clearly respects this guy as being the only one that he couldn't get one over. And the guy respects him back, so everyone's happy. Now he's got some time, and he decides to head off and do some partisaning. What partisaning was basically, you went to your officer and said, I'd like to go fuck up the enemy a little bit. And your officer said, all right, you can sort of do it in this area here. You've got 10 days. Whatever you earn gets split between whoever's with you and a part of the regiment. And you head off. It's a little bit like having a letter of mark, in a naval term. So, off he goes. And... his first job partisaning, the enemy are moving through the forest, and McBane, with his Highland background, probably has a real good idea for hunting. Certainly what he describes makes clear that he knows what he's doing when it comes to hunting in the forest. So him and his men go to ground, there's 10 of them, there's 60 men moving through the forest, and the 60 men stop, they lay up their muskets or whatever to have a drink. The McBane's lot, capture muskets, capture the guys, they've done really well. So the first one goes awesome. The second one, he goes out to do it, and it doesn't go so well. He was hoping to capture like the highest ranking French officers because of some intelligence he got. Anyway, from what he describes, it sounds like someone sleeps in, okay? So he misses them. But in the end, by pure luck, on his way home, they come across another group of soldiers that have happened to put their muskets up. And this group also appeared to have had like a carriage of muskets. They were delivering muskets to the fort. So he makes all of them, he takes the flints out of their muskets and makes them march wearing all the muskets so that his guys don't have to carry anything. And from this experience, he tells us how much he got, and I can't remember, I think he walks away with about £15,000 that day. So he's doing quite well, again, our money. Okay. So that's his entry into partisaning. He doesn't describe doing any more, but presumably he would have. So next up, once again, he gets into an argument, and they go out to get satisfaction. And during the duel, when they get out to the field, McBane draws his sword, the other guy draws his sword, and the other guy goes, "Help, help, help!" And the entire town, like, comes in and starts beating on McBane. Now, he's very unhappy about this being completely unfair. So the entire town beats the hell out of him. He does run away a little bit, but when he gets to go and do one of his famous leaps, he slips and face plants in burn, so the town drag him out and beat him some more. So he's beat into hell. When they're done, they chuck him in a well. Now, we think of a well as being full of water. His descriptions as well was devoid of water. So smack, he hits the bottom of the well. And for 3 days, he's in the well. And eventually, a woman comes along and starts bringing up water. So McBane grabs a hold. So when he gets to the top, the woman sees him, thinks that he's a demon, and goes, "Ah!" and throws him back down the well. And he says the second fall hurt worse than the first, because his feelings were hurt. So anyway, he's down there, he's yelling, he's asking for help. And soon, just by pure luck, some of the officers from his side pull him up. And this time, you know, he goes back to the regiment. He's transferred over to them, and all is good. So that was his time in a well. 1709 rolls around, and during the siege of Tournai, this is fucked up. He's going to attack the fort, and the fort isn't very well defended, but what they do have is a hole in the wall. So they just move one of their guns up to this hole in the wall, with, from what McBane describes, he's running up like a alley like this, and the hole in the wall is right there. There's 42 men in front of him. So they're running up, and things are going well. It looks like this is going to be the easiest siege yet, and bang! And one of his mate's heads is decapitated, flies through the air, and knocks McBane out. So kind of messed up way to go. Anyway, so McBane wakes up, and he feels his brains, and he thinks they're his brains. So he turns to the guy next to him and goes, "Oh my god, my brains are hanging out." The guy goes, "Oh, look, your brains are hanging out, you can't talk." And he goes, "Oh yeah." Gets up and runs back into the siege. I mean, the guy's pretty awesome. So that's the siege of Tournai. Then at the Battle of Malplaquet, and I'm sorry if I'm butchering some of these words, an American education isn't good for learning how to pronounce foreign words. The Battle of Malplaquet, he's heading out to a battle, and by this time he tells us he's got two children and his wife. And they're up at the back, and halfway through his march to the battle, they tell the women and children, basically, run. It's not going to be a good battle. So one of the other women happens to have a horse. So she says she'll take his son for his wife. So they're riding along, and someone comes and tells her that her husband's dying. So she starts riding towards the front with McBane's kid. Sees McBane, throws his child at him, right, and rides off. Okay, so McBane's now marching into a horrific battle with his kid. Being McBane and being a sensible father, he goes, "Ah, fuck it." Puts the kid into his backpack and carries on marching. So he marches on into the Battle of Malplaquet. And at some point during the battle, the kid screams and the child's been shot. He gets a bullet in the left arm. So McBane, from the description, kind of tells the kid, "Man up." Finishes the battle, then goes and finds the surgeon. He's like, "By the way, my kid got shot during that." So the surgeon starts stitching the child up, and the surgeon's like, "Well, you need to give him, you know, like, juice and something to eat." McBane goes, "Well, fuck that, he can have some ale." Gets the child pished. Finally, his wife arrives and is furious, naturally. So that's the that's also the last time we hear of. Now, he calls this wife his second wife. We think he refers to the poor Irish girl as his first wife, but we're not 100% sure, okay? So it might be that there's another wife somewhere in the middle there. But anyway, so that's my own mouth, okay? Now, only 3 years later, we're told that he remarries to his third wife. So I've got a feeling that following that battle, someone gave McBane his marching orders from that marriage, and that seems fair enough. Okay, so, yeah, he gives the kid some whiskey and thinks it's all good. All right, then, once again, McBane gets a hold of a horse. Now, he's really quite fond of this horse. Apparently, it was a very good horse. And, but, he... Right, so he gets a hold of this horse from a dragoon. And then, about 3 days later, the dragoons are told, go and buy your horses back for 1 shilling. We need every man on horse. So, McBane puts, like, a French cover on the horse, so it looks like he stole the horse, and swears to everyone, no, this has always been my horse, I stole a French person, because he wants to get 17 shillings for it, okay? So, anyway, this goes on, and eventually... two dragoons have had enough of McBane. He probably mouthed off, knowing McBane, when they try to take his horse, he tells them to go fuck themselves, and then he stabs both of them. But he does it in front of the Dutch guard outpost. So they all see it. So McBane kind of finishes his jaw, goes, ah, shit, and walks over, is like, alright, time to lock me up. So they lock him up, and they take him to the commander, and the commander is like, well, I'm going to finish my dinner, but you're getting hung following my dinner. So the commander's eating his dinner. McBane's carried out by the provost, and the provost shows him, you know, the noose and is tying it to a tree. And McBane says it's a horrific experience having to watch your own noose being hung from a tree. So that's all going on. And by luck would have it, the aide-de-camp of his officer happens to stop by. So the aide-de-camp sees him and knows who he is, presumably because of all his shenanigans, and says, well, what are you doing? And McBane tells him what's happened and everything. So he goes to the officer and says, look, you're not killing McBane. He says, send him back with me, I'll deal with him. And the officer says, no, I decided I want some after-dinner entertainment. So the officer's a bit of a dick. Anyway, this goes back and forth, and eventually the aide de camp goes back to his camp and returns with, like, a small group of guys, and they free McBane. And McBane doesn't make much out of it, but I can't imagine it was just a simple matter of walking up and unchaining him. But anyway, so they all go back. McBane is court-martialed, and they decide that he did nothing wrong. In fact, they decided that he did so little wrong that because he lost his horse, the officer made the dragoons pay him his 17 shillings for his horse. So McBane once again comes out on top. Well, whether or not he deserves it is up for debate. So, all thanks to the Earl of Orkney's aide-de-camp. So then he gives us another interesting story. He's wandering through the camp one night, and he comes across a couple arguing, right? So McBane goes, and at this point the husband's about to beat the wife, so he steps in the middle and stops the husband. And the wife grabs him by the hair and starts beating the hell out of him. And then the two of them start beating him up. So he warns us at that point that don't intervene in domestic struggles. It's just not worth your time. 1709, an interesting year for him. Now, it gets on to 1712. And McBane's now done his time. He's had enough. And the wars are coming to an end. So McBane returns home, and he remarries to his third wife. And he decides to set up in London. Now, at this stage, I've got to do math quickly. 1664 to 1712, he's 48 years old, okay? So he's an older guy. In Bear's Den in London, there was a prize fighting ring, probably the most famous prize fighting ring in the world. McBane fights 37 prize fights with the falchion in this ring, walks away from all of them. He's an old guy, a lot older guy at 48. Most of these guys have been in their 20s. Anyway, he gets called back off Ice Unit, and he's really proud of this. In 1715, the Battle of Preston, McBane's given the order of guarding, honour of guarding the standard. So what's quite interesting is that Killiecrank and Preston, two of the most the clearest examples of the Highland charge, he sees the Highlanders fighting quite a bit, which gives him some good background for when he's telling us how they used to target. But anyway, so he gets honoured by allowing to guard the standard at the Battle of Preston. Then, 1716, he decides to go back to Fort William, which he built at the start of his career, finish off his career as a sergeant of the dragoons. And he's quite happy there for the next 10 years. And he lives in Inverness and everything. So, now, in 1726, this is one of the more interesting of McBane's stories. He's now into his 50s, and a young Irishman comes over to Edinburgh. And this Irishman arrives in Edinburgh and basically, you know, standing there, like, who wants to take me, all right? He's challenging everyone. He wants to fight someone. So all the nobles and stuff all basically have a whip round to bring McBane out of retirement. So McBane comes south for this. Now, the young Irishman was probably early 20s, probably about 23, roughly. McBane is, I think, 56 at this point. And so he comes down to Edinburgh, and everyone's waiting for this. And what we're told, not only by McBane, but there's also two newspaper articles we have on the subject, and someone's personal, like, journal on it. McBane fights, and he doesn't just win. From the newspaper articles, he gives the Irishman, like, multiple chances to just back down, and the Irishman doesn't take it. So with his falchion, he wounds him 7 times, breaks his arms, breaks his ribs. He really makes his case, especially for a guy in his 50s. He does a spectacular job. And at that point, in 1727, he tells us that he writes his book, and he swears to put up his sword, and that's the end of McBane's travels. So as you can see, he's a fantastic figure, travels all over the place, and just basically a wonderful story of an ordinary soldier that makes a fortune, don't get me wrong, but lives a spectacular life. And he writes and he publishes his book in 1729. Sorry. And he publishes it in Glasgow, and it's sold in the salt market in Glasgow, and the National Library in Edinburgh confirmed the book's authenticity for me. So obviously when we're doing a thesis, we have to make sure this isn't just a Victorian writing a really good story. Kind of like the other book that's very similar, Donald McLeod, another wonderful story, but the authenticity is a bit iffy on that one. So does anyone have any questions about this wonderful chat? Yes?
First of all, how much corroboration is there from everything else? Because you got your newspaper articles in your journal for that last...
The Urban fight.
The
last duel, the Urban.
Yeah. It's very well done. So everything else, we know about the battles, we know about what happened in them from the officer's point of view, and McBane's story tends to line up okay on everything except dates. He seems to get dates kind of mixed up. Now, in fairness, he's writing this book at 57 years old. It might just be a case that he can't quite remember. You know, is this August 5th or August 10th? I mean, you know, in fairness.
With the bullets in his head.
Yeah, he's had bullets and all the rest of it. So, in fairness to him...
Is his military career legit as well? Have you got, like, the army records?
All we have is that he collected his pension.
Okay.
But the army wasn't recording.
Oh, so they don't have where he was enrolled in all these regiments.
No, there's nothing easy. But he's describing battles fairly accurately. And we know from his published date and everything, he was alive during the period. So at the very worst, it's an amalgamation of other people's stories. But it's highly unlikely. You've got to think, a lot of these stories are very over the top. People would have known this guy. There's no way this guy was just sort of some background figure. he'd be well known. And also, you've got to remember, he had his schools in everything, and in every city, he had to fight multiple duels to get himself recognised as a swordmaster. So he was probably relatively well recognised. Also, for the issue in Edinburgh, they knew to bring this guy out of retirement. Now, presumably, there were other swordsmen in Scotland in that period that could have done the fight, but they brought a 57-year-old.
There were schools in Edinburgh at the time.
Pardon?
There were fencing schools in Edinburgh.
Yeah, and there were schools. So you could see this guy, obviously, there is some truth to the story, because his book hadn't come out by that point. But again, it's always worth bearing in mind, there's always the worry that Victorians have a habit of backdating and rewriting stories. So there is always the worry that any of these could be a Victorian fiction. Like I said, Donald MacLeod, that's the problem with it, is we can't... Donald MacLeod, to give you an idea, his story finishes when he's 103 years old, after he marches from Inverness to London and back again four times. After the age of 90. So you can understand why historians were all a little bit worried about saying this is legit or not. There is one theory that it's actually Donald MacLeod's son impersonating him to get his pension. So anyway, any other questions about McBane?
The single one? After the grenade blew off his hand.
It didn't actually blow off his hand from what we can... He just gets horrifically burned. Everyone around him dies. That's probably because he's taken the grenade, and what he describes is he picks it up to throw it, and the grenade fails, and it goes in his hand. It's probably because he's underneath it that saves him. The grenade sort of goes boom out the way, because the base of the grenade, it'd be kind of like this. It would be like a thick clay base and then thin clay walls.
We say grenade now. Have you ever seen a classic Granada? Well, that's a pot.
Yeah, it's like a pot. So that's probably what saved him. At least that's my guess. I mean, he goes on to keep on fighting. He's a cannoneer. He's a musketeer actually later, so he must have had both hands.
Or it says it could have been a fumble, or you either dropped it behind him, or it was a crack a little bit ahead of it. So.
That would have got him. No, I think it was a case that when he's lifted it up, the grenade's gone, and he's been saved and killed everyone around him. Any other questions? He doesn't say, and strangely enough, he doesn't actually discuss a falchion in his out to fight.
He discusses. The falchion isn't what we think of as a falchion, it's actually what's. A lot of people calling it a hanger.
That's interesting.
It was the 18th century hanger, so we're using a lot of purpose. So it's the hunting hanger,
falchion.
My experience of falchion is like the words changed with every kind of thing using it. Right in the early period, it was pretty much like a heavy machete with a guard. And then it evolved into a much more sinuous, much lighter weapon, and then something closer to a mesa. And, the first instance I saw of falchion being used was a curved two-handed sword.
It wouldn't be likely to use his go-to, the small sword or spadroon, because in this fight, he's not to kill the guy. You've just got to cause enough damage the guy can't keep fighting. A heavier weapon.
My memory of this man of fight is that he's actually wounded him. Won't stop.
Yeah, the guy just keeps getting up. He doesn't want to hurt the guy. He calls the guy an upstart and everything, but it's clear that he just views the guy as sort of like a young him, probably. That happens actually a few times in duels with McBane. After that first one where he thinks he kills the officer, he's clearly averse to killing someone in a duel. He quite happily does it in his sieges and stuff, but in duels, he's always very clear that he's very upset whenever he has to kill, because that's not his purpose. Any other questions about the period, who he was?
So he got a job briefly as a pikeman. Is that how we interpret pikemen with the big 20-foot staff or?
Scottish regiment pikeman, he'd probably be using actually a shorter spear. But yeah, pretty much.
So it's kind of like Enforcer in Rex, doesn't have a gun, but much more dangerous.
Yeah, I mean, it just being a mass rank. He's a man of all trades when it comes to the military stuff. Like he says, he's a grenadier, a pikeman, a musketeer, a cannoneer. So he kind of does it all. He's mainly used in sieges. Now that's sort of off. In this period, there's not a lot of pitched battles. You did everything in your power not to enter a pitched battle. Sieges were the way forward. Yeah, because it's huge. Yeah, but that was because the dragoons took their cannons, their baggage train. The dragoons fucked them up before they ever arrived, and then.
And this is obviously classic redcoat period.
Yes, we're told when he's in Ireland that his officer, after the issue with the whorehouse, where the guy doesn't know that he's a soldier, his officer tells him off for not wearing his red coat. He has to wear his red coat from there on out.
Is this just pre-American colonisation, I take it, so that you wouldn't have got shipped out for all this?
When does he finish? 1776 is the Battle of Independence for...
Okay, so he's
about... the War of Independence.
When he's retiring, it's about 50 years before.
Yeah. I think the French-India War is towards the end of his career. Obviously, he's kicking about, for the, what's it called, the Jacobite rebellions and stuff, but he's not sent because they tried to avoid using, for obvious reasons, guys from Inverness to put down the Highlanders, the Highland Jacobite youth.
15 minutes.
Oh, sorry guys, I thought we had a lot longer to chat.
15 minutes, then it goes into lunch.
Okay, cool. So yeah, no, I'll get him out in 10.
Similarly, is there any sort of companion pieces or other contemporary works of the nature? Are there, aside from McLeod, are there other guys writing this kind of...
There probably is. McBane and McLeod are the two that I've studied. Mainly because McLeod and McBane overlap. They're in the same battles and stuff. There's no reason that McLeod wouldn't have known who McBane is. McLeod just carries on a little bit later than McBane. Yeah.
I mean, the interest for me with Ben is he's the other person who's there, Scots, hence a master talking about Swanswood, compared to Hope, who is the very opposite end of the social scale. So he was knighted. He was knighted, but he was also his father that was a lord. So he's very different social circle.
That's interesting.
But he's taught, but they both talk, and we don't have a lot of this evidence actually. A lot of the time about fencing schools, we know about all this stuff in treatises about what they think, what they advocated doing, but they actually, both of them happen to talk a lot about the fact there's masters in the town and how you go and fight and then actually how that works.
And there's multiple masters, which is interesting. Every town he goes to, there's five or six that he has to fight off. There's one town, there's 23, I think, that he ends up fighting off.
Then we're talking about the scholar, the thing I'm talking about, you pray your bribes once a year, and it's a public thing to show you how your school was, and other schools would come and walk. So there's very public art. To be honest, who's going to go and watch the guys doing this fencing other than other people? So there's and you have to do it publicly to show that you're fencing. So there's clearly this stuff happening. And Hope was the first president of the, I can't remember exactly what it was, the Society of Scottish Fencing Masters, essentially, at that point. So there's clearly a lot of these guys in the battle. So I have a theory that one of the problems that McBane will find is that he was a common soldier, and maybe he didn't come from the right
background.
Because fencing, there's always been a class element to them, particularly in some of those aspects. So I do wonder if that was why he was fighting.
And he also feels a little bit put down that he's not French or... Obviously, there's ones that are... The French ones seem to just get a job because they're French. So, you know, it's just that mindset that they must be good. And he's unhappy about this. And so that sort of sets up a little bit of bad feeling with him, with the French ones, because he beats them all.
I mean, 18th century France is, well, Italy is in 17th century, it is the home of fencing.
Yeah, so yeah,
they must be interested
where you want.
French.
What's his thoughts on dueling with pistols? Because obviously he says he gets in a fight and he doesn't like it when the other guy's gone.
He doesn't. There's no point where he mentions an actual pistol duel. There's plenty of duels where it goes wrong, and he does say that before every duel, someone checks them both to make sure that they don't have pistols. There's one duel that I might not have talked about, but anyway, there's two brigands, I think they're Dutch, and they insult him and his mate, so they all go out for some satisfaction. When they get out, they're all checked, and the two brigands had like six guns on them, and so he sort of digs that in as we were more honourable kind of thing. And the two brigands bring, that's it, two brigands bring like a cart to carry the bodies away. And McBane is quite proud that him and his buddy put the two of them into the cart. So, but yeah, he's not a fan of pistols and dueling. But also in this period, I don't think there was much background, because if you killed someone in a duel, you committed murder. In fact, in all periods, there's this idea that duels were allowed to, they were never legal. The last duel fought in British soil, the two individuals were hanged. So you were not allowed to kill someone. There was never any agreement to that. So the pistol obviously has a rather terminal ending, whereas the sword, you can tell from McBane's stories, he gets stabbed many times and what.
I would like to have a sword fight at least, because I'm good at sword fighting. I think I'm better than the other guy pistol dueling.
Yeah, it's luck. I mean, especially in this period, will your pistol actually shoot? You know, it's a luck game, really.
Will it go in a straight line? Yeah.
And he's not as much of a gambler. Like, his story, when you read it, you think this guy's a mad gambler, but he's not actually. He likes to be the one that earning the money off the gambling, so he clearly knows that gambling's a loser's game.
Well, yeah, the house is the only winner. He's going to own the house.
Yeah, exactly. He's a very, very intelligent guy. Pardon? In that period, especially up in like dairies and Inverness and stuff, that would have been fairly common ability. There is the view that the Highlanders were illiterate, which is actually completely wrong. They had high levels of literacy, it's just that they passed stories orally and didn't bother to write stuff down. But most of them could read and write, and most people in Scotland actually in his period would have been okay literate. Yeah, we were.
What was the
special
plan?
Pardon? When there was a relation started in 1910,
yeah, probably.
So start that era and then into the
later 90s. So yeah, he'd have been fully literate, and probably all of his contemporaries would have been as well. Because they kept good records, I mean, of, you know, receipts and that sort of thing. Especially military, they had to be literate because to be recorded stuff. So, alright, thanks guys. Sorry, if you have any more questions about McBane across the event, obviously come find me. Even after the event, get in touch with me on Facebook. If anyone happens to find anything else talking about McBane, I'd love to hear about it. He's a wonderful guy, and please remember that he did more than just run away and jump over a little burn. He had a very full life. We don't know when he died, unfortunately. We just know when he published. And
did his family keep his wealth?
Pardon?
Did his family keep his wealth?
Again, we don't know. He doesn't live like he should.
It sounds like he loses a lot of it.
Yeah, I think he liked to drink. He says that he never used his whores. He sells them, but he's never had an interest in the common woman, which also might give you a hint. He's never had an interest in the common woman, so he might have had quite expensive wives. But again, he's a career soldier. You know, I think wealth was just kind of something that happened in the background and sort of kept him in nice kit. But other than that, he doesn't comment on it the way he should. He likes to drink, though.
I like often as well, he actually got let go
Pardon?
He's in Holland and Flanders and stuff, and campaigning season is the summer.
Yeah.
And you just get dumped in some town.
And by the end of it, it sounds like, you know, the start of the story, he's getting to a town, setting up. Towards the end of the story, he's getting to a town and checking on his people. So he'd have, one of these days, to sit down with it and work out what this guy's net worth is, you know, in terms of schools and prostitutes and all the rest of it. But he was well set up in the area. And occasionally he had to go back to a town and fight someone. He was very angry because two of his game masters ran away with two of his whores, and he wasn't pleased with that. So they fought it out, had a drink, and became friends. You can't, when you read the book, you can't help but come away loving the guy. He is quite good fun.
Do you think there's any basis for him being the inspiration behind stories like Flashman and Sharp and things?
Honestly, these stories, I'm shocked that no one has done McBane. Honestly, it's really surprising that no one's picked up this guy's story, because you wouldn't have to invent anything to have a really good TV series, film, whatever. It's all there. And for anyone that hasn't read the original, it's really easy reading. We're trying to get the museum to picture their copy, because Glasgow University, in a misguided attempt to be nice at the end of my thesis, I wrote it up for permanent archiving, because the fold-out pages were looking a bit worn. What I didn't realise is that meant that no one's allowed to photograph it, it can't come out, it's now sealed. So I kind of screwed myself there, because I went back a year later, I was like, all right, I'm ready to pay for photography, and they were like, no, you wrote it up for permanent archive. Yes, now get it out for the... Nope. So we're trying to get Glasgow Museum, and some of you actually have been kind enough to donate through this event to help us pay for that. So hopefully soon there'll be an actual hard copy of McBane's story, and I definitely advise, get it, read it. His sort of funny stuff at the back, there's not much of it, but it is all good stuff. He gives you some really good, you know, just ideals to remember while you're fighting, things not to do and that sort of thing. So he gives some really good ideas there. I'm not really a small sword spittoon type, that's your area, so, but,
you know. Wear a handkerchief on your hat was very important.
Pardon?
Wear a handkerchief. Wet handkerchief under your hat as protection against sword cuts.
And if you're facing a targe and you don't have one, don't pick one up if you don't know how to use it, and wrap your coat.
The
handkerchief
probably was a big piece of cloth.
Yeah, you've got a hat. Yeah, this guy survives so many cuts and stuff, he probably does know how to survive it, so there's probably something in it.
Like Philip with honey, stitch it up, get drunk.
And he does say to you, you know, it's better to talk it out, drink, and become friends rather than risk a duel. He's not into fighting towards the end of his life, but I suppose he's got a lot to atone for as well, so that might have something to do with it.
Is everything in that book?
Is
there more in his book, or is that...
This book has a transcription of his, and there's some good information here. It's slightly out of date, however. This book's probably... Yeah. It's got a couple of years on it. And the problem is, by doing a transcription, it does lose something. It sort of becomes a lot more surgical, if you know what I mean. Whereas in his, you know... Hearing how he describes me is quite amusing. Obviously, you have to bear in mind that the little F sign is actually an S, and you know, there's the usual. When I was first reading, I kept going, wifedom? What? This guy's obsessed with marriage. Like, I just kept reading about wifedom, and I was like, I don't get it. But it was wisdom. But it's certainly, I like this book just as an easy way of reading the story. I advise. Of course, it's chivalry bookshelf, so getting it might be a bit more difficult these days, but certainly worth getting.
In his tree ties,
yeah.
Is there illustrations?
Yes, depends on the one that you're looking at. For example, I never knew there was actually a picture of him, because Glasgow Uni's one doesn't have it, but the National Library...
The leaves are always seen online, but it's not there.
Yeah, there's definitely one of the books has a portrait.
But he looks quite squat.
Yeah, he's sort of squat. Like, what you'd imagine a Highlander to look like, to be honest, he doesn't disappoint. Big beard and long hair, and then he's got all of his toys laid out. So,
the illustrations in the, you know, for the tree
cards. Yes, in the books, at least Glasgow Uni's one, I'm sure the National Library, it's like a fold-out page, and it shows you sword and targe. And actually, I think most of them are now online. If they're not, when... Oh, no, I've only got the targe stuff. This book has... Here, I'll show you at least. Although I can't remember if they've kind of redone the pictures. Sorry, they've redone it. Search online, you will find there's not many pictures. There's a targe and a pike. All of them. I'll have a look. If I can find a source, I'll put it up on the Facebook page so that everyone can see it. So hope you all enjoyed my little chat. Thanks, guys. And hopefully I'll see some of you for Targe later.